This is a CBC News special presentation.
Hi there, I'm Rosemary Barton. I'm here in the Prime Minister's office on Parliament Hill, where earlier I sat down to discuss some of the issues that matter most to Canadians, to you, with him, whether it be issues of affordability and cost of living, or some of Canada's positions on foreign policy, like India and the Middle East. We also, of course, talked about his government's future, his party's future, and indeed, his own future. Here now, my conversation with the Prime Minister of Canada. Prime Minister, nice to see you.
Good to see you.
Thank you for making the time. I appreciate it.
Always.
I want to start with some issues that Canadians are thinking about right now. Interest rates, as you know, still at 5%. The governor of the Bank of Canada says probably too soon to bring them down. They're still thinking about when that will happen. Many Canadians are going to have to renew their mortgages in the next little bit. So what else are you considering doing to help Canadians as they confront that?
Well, we put out a mortgage charter as part of the fall economic statement to highlight that people can renegotiate their mortgages, get a longer amortization period, and be able to reduce their monthly payments. It's not perfect, but it's part of getting through. One of the other things that happened just in sort of the right time, as mortgages were going up, the childcare costs were cut in half across the country, and not for every family, but for families who have kids in childcare, that's up to like thousands of dollars a month they were saving. With the childcare reduction. So that was able to offset some of the increases in mortgages. But we are really worried about that, and that's why we're continuing to work
on it. Are there other things, though, that are in the offing, as the fall economic statement said?
There are other things we're looking at, yes. But you have to be very, very careful as any time you engage in the housing market, which is why our big focus right now has been on increasing supply and helping people save. About 300,000 people have used the first home buyer savings account already, and that's helping. And on the flip side, the work we're doing to change the way and the speed at which housing is built across this country is making a huge difference already.
Do you think that young people need to start thinking about the idea that they won't be able to afford a home?
No.
That they will be lifelong renters?
No. I think young people are rightly worried about that, because right now the situation is so difficult. But the things we're putting in place means that young people will be able to aspire to own a home. And I take that almost personally, because when we got elected in 2015, it was because a whole bunch of young people who'd never voted before, even into their early 20s, came out and supported us for the first time and the only time. And we made a commitment to them. We were going to make things better, even as we knew things were really, really difficult. Well, there's a global context right now that means we have even more to do, and I need to keep the promise to those young people, and that's exactly why we're focusing so much on delivering that kind of progress and the kind of sustainable future that we know they need.
Okay, well, let's talk about some of the things that are still difficult. The rate of inflation has declined overall, but the food inflation is still punishing for a lot of Canadians. They're feeling squeezed. They have to make really hard choices. Do I get Christmas presents? Do I buy this many groceries? Like, those are real things that are happening to people. It does seem, though, as though Pierre Poilievre understood that and tapped into that long before you did.
Oh, absolutely.
Well, why is that?
It's not that he understood that. It's that he's done a really effective job of reflecting that back and amplifying it to people. We've been hearing that across the country for years now, particularly out of the pandemic.
But why did you not reflect it back and amplify it back? Why was that room left to him?
It wasn't necessarily left to him, but when you're trying to solve an extremely complex situation that requires a number of different solutions. Yes, we delivered a grocery rebate. Yes, we cut child care fees in half. Yes, we stepped up with increasing the Canada Child Benefit. Yes, we're working on competition to make sure that the big grocers don't take advantage of the very small number of very large grocery chains in this country. Mm-hmm. Those are all complex and different paths.
Sure.
Whereas if you're just shouting and saying, it's Trudeau's fault. He's raising the price of everything because he's fighting climate change and put a price on pollution. That's a really easy message. And the things that we are doing are meaningful and real and thoughtful. And you know, we're busy doing them, not just sort of taking out YouTube space on amplifying those concerns.
But is it possible that people no longer like the solutions you have or no longer think the solutions you've put on the table are adequate?
I don't worry so much about that because they're not looking to Poilievre because he's got all these solutions. He's not putting any solutions on the table at all. The solutions he does venture forward, people, experts, not us, criticize as riddled with inaccuracies and unworkable and not going to solve the problem. So we are putting forward meaningful solutions. It's just so much of this is linked to international context. Inflation's high everywhere. It's better in Canada, but that's no comfort when people are having trouble paying their groceries. This is a reality right now that we are working incredibly hard to solve day by day, step by step, and it's starting to work. But Canadians are still frustrated at not feeling it yet, and I totally understand that.
The home heating carve-out, which you've talked about a lot, and all your ministers have talked about a lot, it does, though, seem to me that that carve-out was a recognition that when you have a carbon price and other factors are at play, inflation being one of them and transition is harder, that you are willing to recognize that a carbon price is sometimes too hard for people.
First of all, the reflection around how we put a price on pollution, a carbon price, was always wrapped up in the affordability concerns. We knew that we couldn't fight climate change unless we were also supporting families who in this fight. We can't just land it on people. And that's why we designed it so that across the country, 8 out of 10 families do better with the rebate checks that show up every 3 months than it costs them in carbon pricing. Except in a couple of places where the prevalence of home heating oil, which is dirtier and more expensive, meant that they weren't being as better off. So we saw that as a gap in our approach that we chose to fix. So we're suspending the price on pollution on home heating oil and we're accelerating the transition to heat pumps.
It looked, though, like you were just trying to save a bunch of seats. It looked like you were responding to MPs who were saying to you, if you don't do something to help me, I'm out of here.
No, it was the fact that there were people genuinely struggling, lower income families that are reliant.
Sure, but both things can be true, can they not?
But they were reliant on home heating oil, which is dirtier, more expensive, and more vulnerable to international price shocks. So
sure.
This was a specific thing to solve with people for whom the carbon price wasn't providing
that alternative.
I get that,
but it can also be true that there was a political problem.
Well, politics is about responding to people's problems. And that doesn't mean that there wasn't deep, real policy concerns for it. We chose to phase out oil. Now we're we chose to phase out coal. Now we're phasing out home heating oil. These are things that are good for the environment that go alongside a price on pollution.
Coming up,
that's a point on which I have a very clear disagreement with Prime Minister Netanyahu.
More of my interview with Prime Minister Justin Trudeau. Foreign policy, if I can. It was back in February of this year, a long time ago now, that the Globe first reported on CSIS intelligence memos concerning foreign interference by China. At the time, you said that there were inaccuracies in those reports. And yet, in spite of those concerns and the way that played out over 6 months, no one has been charged with leaking national security information. Do you expect that to happen?
I certainly hope so. The integrity of our intelligence services and, quite frankly, the well-being of people who put their lives at risk around the world in some very dangerous places is at risk every time there are leaks from our national security framework.
Do you have any indication it's going to happen?
I know that work is ongoing right now, but obviously I'm not directly involved in it. It's very serious work being done by the RCMP and other investigative bodies.
Would an inquiry have happened if those leaks hadn't occurred? Probably not. We wouldn't have known those things.
Well, the reality is we have very robust oversight mechanisms, including the National Security and Intelligence Committee of Parliamentarians, which we set up exactly for those oversights so the politicians can raise the flag when things are going. We've been working on foreign interference since back in 2015 with elections oversight, with an election, with NSICOP, the Committee of Parliamentarians, with a rapid response mechanism at the G7 that we created in 2018 when we hosted the G7. We've been doing lots and we're going to continue to do lots, and that's always been a part of it.
You and your officials asked India to cooperate with the investigation into the murder of Hardeep Singh Nijjar, the Canadian man that was killed in Vancouver in British Columbia. You've alleged that India is connected to the murder, as people know, but you have not said very much about how you know that. Is there anything more that you can say at this time about why you are so confident in those allegations?
It is a combination of things. It is intelligence that we've received, including from our allies. It is investigative work being done in Canada that gives us continued confidence in this. But we fundamentally, our role in this is to make sure we're able to keep Canadians safe. Canadians come to this country from every corner of the world, and they need to know that they can be safe in Canada with all the freedoms and liberties that we have here in Canada. And working with other countries like India to make sure that the mechanisms are in place to be accountable if something goes horribly wrong or if actions are taken like this is really important. We don't want to be in a situation of having a fight with India right now over this. We want to be working on that trade deal. We want to be advancing our Indo-Pacific strategy. But it is foundational for Canada to stand up for people's rights, for people's safety, and for the rule of law, and that's what we're going to do.
Since that indictment in the United States, which I'm sure you're aware of, has there been any movement from India, any willingness to cooperate with the Americans and then with us, because that's out publicly now?
I think there is the beginning of an understanding that they can't bluster their way through this, and there is an openness to collaborating in a way that perhaps they were less open before.
What does that mean?
But it means what it is. There's an understanding that maybe just, you know, churning out attacks against Canada isn't going to make this problem go away.
So something has changed since that indictment was made public.
I wouldn't say it's changed, but there might be a tonal shift, perhaps.
Okay. In recent days, your government has changed its stance on the Middle East, now calling for a sustained ceasefire.
We've changed how we've articulated our position, but the position itself hasn't changed. We have always adjusted along the way, but we were one of the first countries to call for humanitarian pauses. We have always said that Israel has the right to defend itself in accordance with international law. We have always called for the protection of civilians. As we enter sort of week 9, week 10, and so forth of this conflict, we need to make sure we are adjusting and moving forward in the best possible way.
I still think that's an evolution in your stance, in spite of what you've
laid out
there.
It's an evolution, yes. Sure. It's not a change in the stance.
Well, okay. So, but the vote at the UN, as you know, did anger some Israelis, some Jewish Canadians who say that there can be no ceasefire until hostages are released, no ceasefire until Hamas is disarmed. What happens if the world doesn't start to see a different approach in Gaza from Israel?
Well, first of all, that is our position, that working towards a sustainable ceasefire requires the conditions of Hamas laying down its arms, releasing all hostages, stopping using human shields, and understanding there is no role for Hamas in the future governance of Gaza, particularly as we move towards a two-state solution. Those are conditions around a ceasefire, which is consistent with the position we've always had.
But to my question, what happens if we don't start to see a change? We're in week whatever, right, of this, and no one expected it to last this long.
Yeah.
And Israel does not seem to be listening to those who are encouraging them to take a different tack.
Well, the voices from Israel's strongest friends, like Canada, like Australia, especially like the United States, that are becoming increasingly concerned that, as we have been for a long time, that the short-term actions being taken by Israel are actually putting at risk the long-term safety and even support for a Jewish state into the future. These are things that have always worried us, and that is why fighting against anti-Semitism at home and around the world, bringing together humanitarian aid into Gaza, showing an absolute understanding that yes, Israel has the right and the responsibility to defend itself, but it has to be doing so in ways that is careful around the impact on civilians.
Do you think Benjamin Netanyahu is interested in negotiating a two-state solution? Is he the future of that conversation?
I had a 40-minute conversation with Prime Minister Netanyahu hours before we changed our vote at the UN. I very much shared with him our deep belief that Canada is unflinching on and has been for many years, that a two-state solution is the only way to move forward, that we have to have a free, secure, viable Israel alongside a free, secure, viable Palestinian state, that there is no long-term future there. That's a point on which I have a very clear disagreement with Prime Minister Netanyahu, but we're going to continue to work for that two-state solution in every conversation we have.
Less than a year from now, Donald Trump may be back as the President of the United States, and many fear that that will have some dire consequences for American democracy, foreign policy, geopolitics. How is your government preparing to work with a man that you have worked with in the past, but how are you preparing for that possibility?
Working with the United States, even, regardless of the administration, I'm on my third now, is always a challenge. The U.S.'s interests and its focus are always going to be something that we have to work through and work around. We were able to solve for some extremely difficult problems during the Trump years, where a threat to rip up NAFTA, a desire to move backwards on climate change, was a menace not just to Canada but to the world. Yes, there's a concern, particularly around the environment, at a time where it's so important to move forward on protecting and building an economy of the future where energy workers, miners, forestry workers across this country and manufacturing across this country continues to be successful as we move towards lower emissions. A Trump presidency that goes back on the fight against climate change would slow down the world's progress in ways that are concerning to me.
Still ahead.
Is there anything that would convince you to step aside and let someone else lead the Liberal Party in this government?
Listen.
The rest of our interview with Prime Minister Justin Trudeau.
You've been Prime Minister for 8 years, I think that's right. And by the end of 2024, you could be the 7th longest serving Prime Minister in history. Your party is struggling. I would say you're struggling a little bit too. Is there anything that would convince you to step aside and let someone else lead the Liberal Party in this government?
Listen, with the challenges that people are facing right now, with the way the world is going now, and everything that we are doing that is making positive differences in a very difficult time that isn't done yet, I wouldn't be the person I am and be willing to walk away from this right now. There is so much important work to continue to do at a time where it is really difficult. It is really challenging, and the global winds that are buffeting not just our democracies but our economies, our social cohesion, mean that the things that we got elected to do, whether it's fighting climate change, reconciliation with Indigenous people, strengthening inclusion and opportunity, and doing it all with a focus on the middle class and people working hard to join it, I think to myself, where would we be right now if we hadn't brought in childcare, if we hadn't shown leadership on climate change and drawing in global investments? We have more to do, and right now, all that is going to be at stake in the next election with a very clear choice of either going backwards and doing less or nothing on climate change, on reconciliation, on inclusion, on growing a strong economy in meaningful ways, or do we keep rolling up our sleeves and delivering for Canadians?
You also had some personal challenges, some changes this year in your life, given your family and your separation with your wife. I wonder whether you think, now that you've had a little time to consider it perhaps, whether it affected your ability to focus on your job, because those are some heavy things happening in the background.
There were, I wouldn't say directly, because I have an amazing team of extraordinary ministers around who are doing great, great work. But one of the things that this personal process and personal year has led to me was a renewed focus on the things that really, really matter. And for me, at the center of it is building a better country and a better future for my kids. And recommitting myself to that specifically and to the work that we still have to do to make sure that Canada continues to be the best country in the world, that has given me new energy, and I'm excited about all the very real challenges we're going to face in 2024.
What is Where do you find optimism right now? Because I think that's something Canadians are struggling with, right? I think there is a frustration, anger, impatience, yeah. all those things. And I wonder where you find that and where you would tell them to find it.
Two things. First of all, a lot of the things that we're putting into place now are going to be delivering in the coming years, as we're seeing inflation getting under control, as we see interest rates hopefully coming down in sometime in 2024, that's going to take pressure off. As we see $10 a day childcare become a reality across the country. But the building blocks are there. But even that's not even where I draw most of my inspiration from. It's our fellow Canadians. We saw it during the worst forest fire season in history over the summer. The way people stepped up for each other, the way people were there for each other, the way people are there now with food banks, with supports, the way communities are coming together. Yeah, they're united and all being mad at the federal government and the governments right now because there's something to be mad about there. But at the same time, those people who throw up their hands and say, oh, Canada's just broken, couldn't be wronger, because Canadians are not broken. They're facing really tough times, mm-hmm. but we're doing what we always do as Canadians. We roll up our sleeves, we're there for our neighbors, we lean into the headwinds, and we succeed.
Some people don't buy that, though.
I understand how tough it is right now.
Yeah.
But what people need to be looking for is who is actually looking to solve the challenges we're facing, and who's just looking to exploit them or amplify them. And that is going to be the choice that will shape the next 2 years in politics.
Prime Minister, thank you for your time. I appreciate it.
Always a pleasure, Rosie.